But in the process of this discussion that I've gone through with waste for 27 years, it's very clear in my mind that the world is poised between two separate pressures. One pressure is for the public interest, to do things in the public interest, and the other thing is to do things in the corporate interest. I don't think there'd be much left on our planet for us. Our lifestyle would be pretty small and miserable compared to what we have today if it's all left to the corporate interest, the just making money for making money, no morality, etc., just consume, consume, consume. There would be nothing left. So really, we have to frame our policies all the time and have to think all the time in the public's interest. And so that brings into the issue of where governments are. Now, as far as politicians are concerned, not many of us trust most of them or think hugely of their intelligence. But what about the bureaucrats? What about the civil servants? What about the regulatory officials that are working in the EPA, in the FDA, in the Health Canada, in Environmental Canada? These people are supposed to be working for us in the corporate interest. They are paid by us to give to the politicians objective truth, honest analysis. That's what we expect. And one of the shocks when you get embroiled in these campaigns, whether it's for genetic engineering or organic food or medicine or whatever, is that they're not working in our interest. They are not telling the truth. They're not being objective. And it's a shock. And most people out there are probably oblivious to this. Shiv Chopra wrote a book about Health Canada. I'm sure lots of citizens don't believe him in what happened. But it is true. Something is like fluoridation. Now go to the other hand. Health Canada, in 2006, appointed 6 experts to look at the safety and effectiveness of water fluoridation. Of those 6 experts, they chose 4 pro-fluoridation dentists to review the literature. I mean, you don't need to be a rocket scientist to see that that is not an honest exercise. So one message that comes out of this is we must insist upon integrity. Not just integrity of our bureaucrats, not just integrity of our scientists, because many of these scientists are being bought off by Monsanto and the others, but our children. If there's one thing that our schools should teach, is you tell the truth. Mm-hmm. You don't lie. And anybody that asks you to lie, tell them to get stuffed, and if that's what the job entails, leave that job. And unless we instill that into our young people in the future, it's going to be one damn crisis, one damn sellout after another. That's pretty simple stuff. Now, just a little bit more about fluoridation on the history, because the economic interests, the corporations, and putting fluoride in the water. Putting fluoride in the water, here we've got a mix of petroleum of water and medicine. Because it's a pretty daft thing to do when you think about it, is putting a medicine in the water. Because one of the things that you have to do with medicines is to control the dose and control who gets it. And once you put it in the water, you can do neither. Incidentally, the Food and Drug Administration has never regulated fluoride, and yet it's the most prescribed medication in North America. There's something wrong with this picture. Okay, so it was a daft thing to do. So what about a little bit of the history? The first person to recommend a fluoridation of the drinking water was not a dentist or a doctor. He was a scientist being employed at the Mellon Institute with great connections to the aluminum industry. Gerald Cox, he was the first person to actually recommend that fluoride be added to the drinking water in 1939. the studies which suggested it might be reducing tooth decay didn't come till 1942, Dean's famous 21 city study. Anyway, the trials began in 1945, and I want to draw your attention to something that happened in 1949. So the trials began in 45, they were meant to be 10-year trials. The US government endorsed fluoridation in 1950, before any of those trials had been completed, for effectiveness, before there's practically any medical studies in the literature, before they put this medicine in the drinking water. 1949, 1 year before that event, the sugar lobby, the Sugar Research Foundation, which represented 133 sugar interests, said, we need to find a way to reduce tooth decay without reducing sugar consumption. They then proceeded to pay enormous amounts of money to various university nutrition departments. They even set up nutrition departments. The most famous was at Harvard, lovely Harvard, what a respectable institute that is. The chairman of the Harvard University Nutrition Department was a gentleman called Dr. Fred Stair. And Dr. Fred Stair went around saying how wonderful sugar was for health, that Coca-Cola was a nutritious drink. Yes, the cookies and things like that were marvelous snacks for children.
Was he smoking at the same time?
And for 40 odd years, he promoted fluoridation aggressively. He attacked anybody who was opposed to it. Same man attacked the lady who Silent Spring, Rachel Carson, and she wrote it. He used all his, he had a tremendous vitriolic tongue. Anyway, you have to read, that was one interest, one economic interest that gave us fluoridation. And maybe they also gave us obesity, because once parents thought that they had this magic bullet to fight tooth decay, they took their eyes off the prize of making sure that their kids did not consume so much sugar between meals, etc., etc., etc. So we have that to thank them for. But you have to read Chris Bryson's The Fluoride Deception to see all the other economic interests that were behind fluoridation. All those industries that were producing fluoride as a pollutant, who were exposing their own workers to this very toxic substance. You need to know that in 1937, the Department of Agriculture said that fluoride as a pollutant has done more damage to agriculture than any other air pollutant. That was the thing. The aluminum industry, the phosphate fertilizer industry, the oil industry, the ceramic industry, the brick industry, you name it, nearly every industry was producing a huge amount of fluoride, the uranium, the nuclear industry. All these interests got together, and according to Chris Bryson, there was collusion between the US Public Health Service and the Fluorine Lawyers Association. There's exchange. Fluorine Lawyers Association were representing these manufacturers. And what Chris Bryson's thesis is, the introduction of fluoride as being safe enough to put into your drinking water was to completely undermine any notion that fluoride was a nasty air pollutant, undermine any potential lawsuits that workers might take out against fluoride. I'm going to end it, just one more thing. Now that, I think, Chris Bryson does a brilliant job of explaining why this all started. He doesn't talk about sugar, but as far as the other industries. Is there any evidence that these people are still in play today? And the answer is yes. Here's the evidence. The American Council on Science and Health, the ACSH, run by Dr. Elizabeth Whalen, is an industry front. It's funded by industry. It's funded by all these polluters and the food industry and you name it. They've never found a chemical that they didn't like. They even like dioxin. They probably love Monsanto. And they are still, to this day, vitriolic in their defense of fluoridation. When Peter Vallone Jr. of New York City tried to introduce a bill to stop fluoridation in New York City, who jumped out there to attack him but the ACSH? So you have to wonder, why are they doing this? And I suggest to you, it's telling us that these industries that are still could be faced with lawsuits for fluoride damage to their workers are still in play, still concerned to keep fluoridation going.
Our next speaker is Alan Cassels, who's here from the University of Victoria in British Columbia. He's a drug policy researcher, and he's written a few books. His first book is called Selling Sickness, How the World's Biggest Pharmaceutical Companies Are Turning Us All Into Patients. He's also written a new book called Seeking Sickness. And in honor of your new book, Alan, I thought it would be fun to read a little poem from another one of your books called The ABCs of Disease Mongering. He's quite a poet, very talented. Quinn was on a noble quest to find his perfect health. He had about a million tests befitting of his wealth. When nothing told him anything, he tried to push his luck, but doctors all just shook their heads and ended up quite stuck. He paid $1,000 to get a CAT scan answer. They uncovered what he dreaded, a lump that could be cancer. It didn't turn out all that bad. The lump was found benign, better than the nasty bug he picked up at the time. Quinn will tell you, now you ask, his awful tale of woe, and remind you, yes, that sometimes it's better not to know. Welcome, Alan.
Did you know that if you sell 500 copies of a book of poetry in Canada, you're considered a best-selling poet? Apparently, they've sold about 600 of that book, so that's pretty exciting. Yeah, I wouldn't call it poetry, though. It's doggerel. One of the reviewers said it was like, you know, Dr. Seuss taking on the medical disease industry. So I wrote this new book, just came out this week. It's called Seeking Sickness. And I'm just going to start by telling a very brief story. There's a woman in Vancouver named Mary Brown. And she works in a community college. She's a professor. And when she was around 50 years old, she was her father had died. She was clean. She was dealing with his estate. And at her father's funeral, a couple of her friends, they started talking about this idea of maybe she should consider getting a mammogram. She'd never had one, and she said, it seemed like a good thing to do. So she ended up going to her physician, and of course she was in the age category where they offer mammograms to women 50 and older, and she submitted to this test, and they found something that was unusual. And what they did next led her on a cascade of medical intervention that was truly frightening. What happened in the course of getting the biopsy, which is where they usually insert needles to extract tissue samples to see if there's any cancerous cells there. They implanted a little metal chip. And you might say, well, why would they do something like that? There is a good rationale for that, because if there is actual cancer at that spot, when they go on to do the surgery, so they can find it easier. So they left this little metal chip in her.
Oh my.
She didn't know that this was going to happen. She ended up 8 months later, she was off work, she was suffering panic attacks, dizziness, nausea, she couldn't work. It was a truly frightening and catastrophic event for her. She, I think, ended up becoming what I would consider to be a classic activist who, when they submit to some kind of medical screening test, a drug or a procedure, and it goes wrong, she starts to get very angry, and she wants to prevent this from happening to other people. You know, when you look at and she's gone on to do that, and I think written some very good information for consumers around what you need to know when you get a mammogram. And what's really interesting is that though you've got breast cancer activists, and you've got, and I say activists in the sense of breast cancer lobby groups that are paid partly by the pharmaceutical industry and the medical screening industry, and what they do is that they will promote screening as something that you have to do early and often. Mm-hmm. But what they don't do is give you information about the downsides of screening. Now, mammography is a very good example. In the book, I talk about 10 different examples of medical screening, but mammography is very unique in the sense that it's actually being studied. There are studies that are at least a decade long looking at, do the women who undergo breast cancer screening do better than the women who don't undergo breast cancer screening? One thing that Mary Brown wasn't told when she went and submitted to her first and only mammogram is that the best research so far says that in order to save one life, one woman's life from breast cancer, you have to screen 2,100 women every year for 11 years to prevent one death. Of those 2,100 women, 690 of them will have a false positive or something unusual in their mammogram for which requires follow-up. 75 of those women are going to get unnecessary biopsies. And what is not measured in this kind of research is the psychological torment and the ups and downs and the emotional roller coaster that anyone getting a positive cancer test is going to undergo. The reason I mention mammography is because it is the most and best tested of all screening paradigms. Another one, which is PSA testing, and this is where you get men to submit to a blood test. It measures an antigen in your blood, and they can determine, they associate that with a higher level of a risk of having prostate cancer. The problem, of course, when you do this is that you won't be telling men that, guess what? Most men at a certain age will develop prostate cancer in their life. It's a normal thing. And in fact, when you look at people, say, my age, between, say, 40 and 50 years old, about 40 to 50% of us are going to have a test that will say that we have prostate cancer. But you say, well, that's a good thing. We can do something to prevent that, prevent the men from dying from it. That's really what you want to prevent. So when you look at the research on prostate cancer testing, you find that you have to test 1,400 men with a PSA test, and you will, at the end of the day, save one life. But of those 1,400 men that you test, 48 of them will undergo treatment for their prostate cancer, which wouldn't have gone on to kill them. And those 48 men will get surgery, they'll get drug therapy, they'll get a range of other things, and some of those will die from the consequences of the biopsy and the surgery. And about 60% of men that go through prostate cancer treatment will end up impotent or incontinent. Mm-hmm. One doctor told me that if you go through a PSA test, you won't live longer, but your life will feel longer. I mentioned PSA and mammography. They're almost in a separate category because I can give you numbers about those. I can tell you that they've been studied, and I can tell you that there are patient groups out there, pharmaceutical manufacturers and device manufacturers, pushing those treatments and pushing those screening paradigms on most of us, and convincing our doctors that if you're not offering your female patients mammograms or your male patients PSA tests, then you're not.